sometimes just before breakthroughs, you have a period of almost like you're frantic or panicky. That's what happened to me yesterday. And then this morning, I had this tremendous breakthrough. And so it shows you that don't give up. Keep your poise under all circumstances. And when you feel like you're stuck and you're frustrated and you think, I'm just not getting anywhere. That's how I felt, like I haven't done anything. And then suddenly this morning, after working a lot, suddenly I said, oh my gosh, wow. So, progress is made. It's just that you reach, you have ups and downs, peaks and valleys, as it were. Now, what was the big breakthrough? That is the question. Well, I've been talking in videos about the inner Christ child, which is really a way that the Holy Spirit symbolizes flesh to us. Another way of looking at it is the Holy Spirit's way of perceiving the flesh, all flesh, let's say all human flesh, flesh, bodies, personalities, the whole flesh thing. The Holy Spirit sees us all as this little Christ child. That's genderless, neutral, very light, little child, maybe, you know, like a 43-year-old or 4-year-old or something, just in very peaceful, very calm, and hardly any flesh at all. You know, it doesn't have the feel of flesh at all. That is how it sees all flesh, not just you, me, someone else. All flesh, human flesh, it sees, its perception is of this little Christ child, Santo Niño, the little Christ child. And so we have access. We can go to the Holy Spirit and say, okay, Holy Spirit, how do you see the flesh? How do you see people? How do you see humanity? And then you can literally, it will share its perception with you. And so then you get this vision of this Christ child, okay? This wonderful, non-fleshy human. So at least there's some continuity, some familiarity. We're still perceiving humanness, so to speak, instead of the complete formless. The Holy Spirit is itself formless, but it was put in charge of space, time, and perception. God created the Holy Spirit to be in charge of space, time, and perception, and to solve the continuity problem for spirit. Because we can't, of ourselves, we can't solve the continuity problem. We cannot. We can drop all of our of existence. We can drop it instantly. The whole universe, we can disappear for us. That's all we can do, though. But we cannot solve the continuity problem. Of myself, I can do nothing. We must say that. I can do nothing. I cannot solve the problem, the continuity problem. We need to make these I cannot statement. No, I can never solve the continuity problem. I'll never be able to succeed at that. That is true. Very true, because remember, we can't change what we are. We were created to function in a certain way, in other words, in reality. When we try to make a separate reality, we're not able to blend the two. We're not able to do the things that we think we can. We think we can change what we are. We think we can change our functioning. We cannot. We cannot change our functioning. It's impossible. So we, without the Holy Spirit, I would say that we would definitely have an extreme problem. We can theoretically set the whole thing down, which is, I believe, in ancient times, that there would be meditative exercises. People would spend lifetimes and lifetimes trying to detach from the sensory input and trying to get to the point where they can just drop the whole thing. So it's not impossible to drop existence. We can do it, but very, 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 very difficult and long term, and it's prohibitively difficult, actually. But what Jesus Christ did is, according to him, he was the first one to completely embrace the Holy Spirit and allow the Holy Spirit to solve the continuity problem. Whereas prior to that, they didn't quite trust the Holy Spirit. They wanted to find, try to drop existence altogether. Find some way to do that. It's a decision, and it can be done. But apparently Jesus activated the Holy Spirit, so to speak, by embracing it and accepting its function perfectly. It showed everyone, this is the way. This is the way God created to help us, help us with the delay factor. Without the Holy Spirit, it would be a very, 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 very long and difficult prospect to get to the point where we can simply, you know, just have the whole, all perception just vanish like that, just gone. So we do have the Holy Spirit, and it was specifically created to deal with the continuity, the issues that we have, the difficulty we have, specifically created for that. So it knows exactly how to function in regard to time, space, and perception, and how to use time, space, and perception to remind us of reality, to give us the gift of remembrance. So it doesn't attack what we are imagining, doesn't attack the flesh, it doesn't attack impermanence, it doesn't attack anything. It will reinterpret it for us. So instead of saying, well, you have no body, you are not a body, I am not a body, I'm only spirit, it says, hey, here's a vision of the body, human body, for you, that will remind you of reality. And the Santo Niño, the Christ child, is that vision of the flesh that the Holy Spirit has, and that vision it will share with each and every one of us. So what an amazing gift to realize that we can be free of viewing flesh. And in every single instance of flesh in the world, instead of seeing the fleshy person there, we see the Christ child there instead. That is what we will be perceiving. And the ramifications of this are enormous. It's just fantastic, actually, is that we don't have to, again, not see any bodies at all. We can't see the Christ child, everyone as the Christ child, all flesh as one. Okay, here's this. All flesh is seen as one. Just this little Christ child is the substitute for all the bodies in the universe, all the flesh in the universe, at least as far as, you know, human bodies, we're thinking of that. I don't know how it deals with animals, etc., etc. That will be clarified at some point, but for us, as far as we're concerned, our continuity issue, that is the substitute, that we substitute that, the Holy Spirit substitutes that for all flesh. Amazing. So we cannot free ourselves from the continuity issue. We really cannot, but with the proviso of what I've said, it's prohibitively difficult and getting more so all the time with the situation that we have in the world. The Holy Spirit is the way to go. It is specifically designed to help us. We don't have the functionality to do the stuff the Holy Spirit does. We simply do not. The Holy Spirit reinterprets all flesh, all nature. I'm not exactly sure what its reinterpretation of nature is, but I'll find out, I'm sure, soon. It provides this incredible gift of remembrance of what we really are. See, we don't need to resolve anything. We simply need to remember reality. See, we cannot resolve the problems of existence. It's impossible for us, completely impossible. And we don't need to. We only need to remember reality, you see. So all the problems in existence, all the problems that bodies have, etc., etc., the Holy Spirit just shows us this perfect Christ child, which has perfect health, perfect psyche, perfect personality. Everything is flawless, okay? And it still appears as if it's a body. But that reminds us of reality, okay? So we cannot create a separate reality and then fix the problems of this separate reality. It's impossible. In other words, like, we cannot cure whimsicality. There's no cure for whimsicality. None. There is, however, remembrance of reality, and we choose that instead. So it's not a matter of curing anything. It's a matter of choosing. Okay, not cure, but choice. All right. not repairing the problems, but remembrance of reality, remembrance. So the whimsical, again, there's no cure for it. It's incurable. But we don't have to choose that. We don't have to choose it. We have the option of choosing reality instead of the idea that reality can be destroyed, which is whimsicality. But within the context of whimsicality, there is no cure. There is no cure. And we have to accept that and realize that there isn't any cure at all for existence. So everybody's searching for the cure, and counterintuitively, I'm sharing with you the Holy Spirit's perspective. There is no cure. There is no cure at all. But there is a choice. And we can choose instead the Holy Spirit's perception of all this as a gift of remembrance, and then remember reality and say, ah, that's what I really want anyway. I don't need this dream. I don't need this dream. But within a dream, if you accept the dream as real or potentially real and something you want, then there is no cure for it. You're still, because whimsicality can do anything it wants to do, can imagine anything it wants to do. It can imagine there's a new reality, imagine there's a new God, it can imagine anything at all. There's no cure at all. And so this whole game of trying to find a cure is off track, completely off track. Completely off track. So not a cure, but the Christ child, vision of the Christ child within us. Say, ah, this reminds me of reality. It will remind us of reality. That's the whole game is remembrance of reality. Not beauty for its own sake, not anything for its own sake, except that it has a pragmatic function of reminding us of the nature of reality, which the Holy Spirit knows how to use space and time and perception to reflect reality, remind us of reality. We cannot do that. We're not created with that function. We literally can't do it. And so we say, of myself, I can do nothing. Of myself, I can do nothing. I don't know. I don't know how to do it. I don't know how I can do it. Because I cannot. I cannot do it. So I can say, I cannot do it. I can't do it. I'll never be able to do it. There's no way I can do it. But the Holy Spirit can do it for me. So this is the whole shift away from, gee, I need to do it, so how can I do it, to I can't do it. But the Holy Spirit has done it for me. It's a gift from God. See, if we don't trust God, we will keep trying to do it ourselves, which many have tried that route. They don't really, they think that God's been damaged or is gone or reality is no longer real or something. They feel they don't trust it. But the Holy Spirit is a gift from God, and the more we can trust it, we can get to a point where we can accept its remedy, which is then very, 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 very effective. Which is why the education in the world has to be about the Holy Spirit. If we neglect that, we're just, what are we doing? Just perpetuating bad habits. You know, that's not an education. The purpose of education should not be to perpetuate bad habits. But in fact, that is what happens in this world. It's just the perpetuation of bad habits. There's no education. It's a miseducation. Actually, it's taking place. The idea of real education is to make you aware of better habits. All right? To break the bad habits by showing you, here's some good habits. So do those. Do those. Focus on that. And that's what we're doing here. This is a good habit to have. A good habit to have is to listen and consider and get familiar with what the Holy Spirit has to offer us, actually, because it has the remedy for us. We don't have the remedy for ourselves. We do not. Never will. We will never have the remedy for ourselves, because we were not created to reconcile dreams and reality. We were not. Because then we would say, well, God wants us to dream then so we can fulfill our function. We were not created to reconcile dreams and reality. Not created to resolve the continuity issue between dreams and reality. We were not created to do that. We cannot give ourselves the ability to do that. We need to rely on the Holy Spirit. or just drop dreams and don't even try to deal with the cognitive problem at all, which is prohibitively difficult, really prohibitively. There may have been a few throughout all of history, maybe a couple who may have been able to do that, but it's prohibitively difficult. So we're not even that's not even an option, really. From a pragmatic standpoint, it's not really an option on our plate. So we do need the Holy Spirit. People do need the Holy Spirit. So this morning, if someone were to ask me how I felt or was feeling, I would say, I feel perfect right now. I feel perfect right now. This is actually a statement of the Holy Spirit saying, the Holy Spirit, if you say, how do you feel right now? You should reinterpret that as saying, what is the Holy Spirit showing me now? That's the right way to look at this. And you could say, right now it's showing me perfection. Right now it's showing me perfection. So you could say, instead of saying, how are you feeling right now? You can answer, well, right now the Holy Spirit's showing me perfection. And then the ego will say, well, yeah, what about tomorrow? I say, well, right now, showing me perfection. And I don't see any progression of that perfection. It's already perfect, so it doesn't need to change. So I'm not asking it to change. So tomorrow, you can ask me tomorrow if you want, if you need to. But right now, I feel perfect. Right now, I'm seeing perfection. Right now, I'm seeing perfection. And then just abide in that perfection. So each moment, whenever someone asks you, you say, well, right now I'm being shown perfection. Right now. So right now I'm being shown perfection. This is something to get ourselves ready for, to say, well, right now I'm being shown perfection. Not perceiving, being shown it. We're being shown. Like a movie is being shown to us. It's as if we're being seen. Everything is being seen by the Holy Spirit in this way. It's not our seeing. It's the Holy Spirit's seeing. It's the Holy Spirit's perception, reinterpretation of time, space, and all forms that arise in time and space. So we say, right now, the Holy Spirit is showing me perfection. And the ego wants you to prepare for a time when it will not be showing you perfection. But it's its function to show us perception. So I have faith that its function, it will continue to function as it was created to function. And the ego will never accept that, because this whole thing is that we can change our functionality. Whereas we have to accept the facts of reality, we cannot change our functionality. So, prepare your expectations to say, right now the Holy Spirit is showing me perfection. It's not something that I'm doing. I'm being shown it. I'm being shown perfection. And this reminds me of reality. So we could say a lot more about this, etc., but the basic issue, we've gotten to the basic issue, and that is that this entire issue is capable of really taking root and flowering for us. Absolutely is. And absolutely expected. Tremendous amount of work, and I had a dream last night where I was... Somebody, I came into the world and some friend said, came to me and said, I'm your friend. And this sort of like, oh, I need to take care of this friend. And it turns out this friend had some mental problems or something. I had to take it into a mental, this friend into a mental institution and stuff. And all through all the processing and paperwork and trying to help them and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Eventually, the doctors, everybody's there so geared to view everyone as a mental patient, that they began viewing me as a mental patient. And then the upshot is I couldn't get out. I couldn't get out of there. But I knew the way out, actually. There's a way out that they cannot block. There's definitely a way out. you get in that environment of a mental institution, and you start losing your own confidence, and you feel you can't leave, and you need to be treated, and all this kind of stuff is an amazing dream. And I said, wait a minute, I know the way out is very simple. There's this area where you can just walk in and walk out, but nobody does it. Nobody does it. They all think it's like the cage-free chickens that, you know, they say these eggs are cage-free chicken. From eggs from cage-free chickens, or what I understand is they raise the chickens in cages up until a certain point. And then technically they only have to have the door of the cage open so many hours a week or something. So they open the doors up like a little minimal amount of time. The chickens are so completely used to being in cage that they don't even go out of the cage. They don't go out the open door. They don't. They just stay right in the cage, and then they close them again. So those cage-free chicken eggs are from caged chickens. It's just a labeling scheme that is being used, because the chickens, they don't go out of their cage. So we're like those chickens, to tell you the truth. Is even though there's this way out, we don't use it. We don't utilize it. We just don't utilize it. Amazing. Yeah, so what you want is free range chicken eggs. Free range, meaning there's no cage. They're just walking around all the time. There's no cages at all. Free range. There's some labeling thing with that too. With the prices they charge, it better be something, you know, significantly better. It's like twice the amount or something. So there is, definitely is a way out. No question about it. I saw it this morning. Oh, definitely is. But we're so conditioned to think of ourselves as, you know, because we don't have the ability to change our function, we think of ourselves as mentally defective. We're not mentally defective. The inability to change our function doesn't mean we're mentally defective at all. But the ego claims that we are. Since we can't change our function, the ego says, well, you're mentally defective. You need to have therapy so you can learn how to change what you are. It's impossible to change what you are. So these people will be in mental therapy. I mean, we're in this training program, and they just stay in it and stay in it and stay in it and stay in it, and they're such bad shape. Because they just keep thinking, like, I'm so stupid. What's wrong with me? How come I can't change my function? What is the matter with me? And that's that inner negativity towards ourselves is really the ego telling us, hey, you're really inept and stupid and incapable because you can't change your function. There's something severely wrong with you. You really need an intensive long-term therapy so you can figure out how to change your function. You can't change your function. You look at these people. In the dream, I looked at these people who have been in this therapy for so long. I said, they were like worse than ever. It's like horrible, horrible. I said, wow, that's awful. I felt so sorry for them. But the thing is you cannot make them any better as long, because they believe that they have to learn how to change their function in order to get better. Completely false. So the whole premise is false from the very beginning. And that is where all spiritual teaching, all teaching has to rest upon that, that the basic premise is false. If you don't start there, then you got no chance. Everything's gonna get completely confusing. So the entire premise that we are basing our efforts and our valuations upon is that we can change our functionality, which is untrue. It's factually untrue. What God created is set. God created us. What we are is set. We cannot change what we are. And it's a good thing. So these poor mental patients, you know, I saw everything in this mental institution. I saw so much, which kind of mirrors my life of just seeing everything in this world so much. So people are in such bad shape. You know, just they're so down on themselves. They're so down on themselves, and they're so boosterish of silliness, whimsical, trivial silliness. And they're in the grip of this. It's so sad. It's so sad to see to see one of my, you know, fellow spirits, just enmeshed in this repetitive kind of triviality, and they just, you know, like a lunatic. It's just, they can't, you know, it's just, they're desperately trying, hoping that their obedience to this robotic program, whatever they're doing, is going to finally help them shed their stupidity and incompetency, which they actually don't even have at all, because we can't change ourselves. So it's not an issue of incompetence or stupidity at all. Totally bogus. Now Jesus says when one accepts the Holy Spirit's remedy, then others go seek for them, so that they can see it for themselves. You know, like, hey, yeah, this really is true. So I just have to take that as gospel truth, that will happen at someday. But on the surface, it appears that people are really bad off, actually. But I know through doing these videos that there are some people in the world, actually, who really do have a sense of it, you know? They do have a sense, like, it's there. But I'm telling you, it is very, from this dream, I realized it's very difficult. You can really doubt yourself. That's even, you know, I'm struggling with that. Even I, after all this work, still have self-doubts about it, you know? Even though I can see easy to, I can be free. Still, there's these doubts, so it's enormously difficult to shake off this stuff if we don't get any help, and if we keep on accepting this incredible, horrible way of life and civilization and culture that we have, that just ignores this entirely and tells everybody, you know, you're just so incredibly incompetent, stupid, but we can work with you. We can work with you. We can. And then it gives all the song and dance and trivial stuff, and people just their minds, they don't even hold out any hope at all. Really, it's just a very sad thing. But eventually, you know, they will finally, one way or another, start seeing some cracks in that cosmic egg, as it were, and dimly sense something, and dimly try to go grope their way towards some light, you know, just gradually they'll go along and drag themselves a little bit, and eventually they'll start waking up, you know, eventually. But it's a tricky thing. We've done a good job tricking ourselves, scaring ourselves, and telling ourselves that we're nothing if we are unable to be other than what we are. How is that true? We're nothing if we cannot change what we are. Well, how about if what we are is wonderful? Then how can we be nothing? How does that add up? Where's the calculus there? I don't see it. If what we already are is wonderful, then how could the failure to change that mean that we're nothing? Are not wonderful. It's total whimsicality. See, there's no logic to whimsicality. There's no logic. There's absolutely no logic to it. We just cannot handle this lack of reason and logic. It just, we just attribute logic to it. You know, we say, well, you must be mean this and this and this, but really, there's no logic to it. It is pure will, pure whimsical will of just saying, well, this is what I want. But this is how I want to see it. Even though there's nothing there to add up at all. So it is indeed, you cannot really deal with whimsicality. So let the Holy Spirit deal with whimsicality. Okay, the Holy Spirit has been created to deal with whimsicality. That's another way of putting it. We are not. We're not able to deal with it. So we keep attributing purpose and plausibility and to it. Say, well, this is what you must mean. This is how, and that keeps things going and going and going and going and going. Whereas really, if we see how it really is, it's pure whimsicality with no, interest in logic or anything. It's, you might say, total madness, but it's really total whimsicality. We can't deal with that. We absolutely cannot deal with it. The Holy Spirit can deal with it perfectly. So let the Holy Spirit deal with the whimsicality. That's the answer. And give us the results. let it have the contest, and it will then give us the results that it attains from that. And the results are fabulous. So this is a new way of looking at the whole spiritual situation. This is what this channel, Christ Clarity, is for. Is a new way of looking at spirituality, spiritual truth. A new way of looking at it. And it's really clarifying the truly classical way of Christ. And it needs clarifying because people are very, very, you know, they have such low opinions of themselves. They say, oh, I'm so incompetent, stupid, so maybe I'll just attribute a bunch of stuff to whimsicality. I'll attribute a whole bunch of that, and so I'll settle for this and this. And so it's hard to get this clarity on the truth and on what this new way of seeing truth is, seeing the spiritual path, a new way of seeing the spiritual path. Very difficult to get it in focus. So it's been a lot of work to do this. And again, it's saying, I can't do it. I cannot deal with whimsicality at all. I can't. So it's either I drop it entirely or I stay under its power by myself. That's the only options I have other than the third way, the third option, which is to choose the Holy Spirit and let the Holy Spirit deal with whimsicality right now. And then we'd simply experience the outcome of that. How about that? See, this is a better way of looking at the whole situation. We can literally turn it all over to the Holy Spirit this instant, and we'll get then the outcome. That is what we're supposed to do. This is the easy way. It's the fast way. It's what works, the pragmatic way. And it's the way that we need to bring in focus. And like I said in that dream, people were really having a rough time in the mental institution, which we call this world. As a matter of fact, what I found out was, I saw the doctors and everyone was treating. All the doctors are completely mad too. They're all mental cases too. That's a fact. That is really a fact I saw. That those who are pretending to be the therapists and doctors, etc., they're all mental cases too. They all have the same problem of believing that they too are incompetent. And they're just playing the role of helping others reassure them that, yes, you can gain your competence. We will help you gain your competence in changing yourself. We know you feel very inadequate, but we're going to show you how you can gain adequacy through changing what you are, changing your function. And of course, that's complete whimsicality, complete madness in itself. So I found the entire structure of this mental institution was all completely mad, completely based on whimsy. It is not easy to get this perspective when you're in the midst of this institution, this insane asylum, Ananda Maima called the world an insane asylum, literally. And that is actually literally fact. It is an insane asylum. We live in an insane asylum. We're surrounded. And most of everyone in this insane asylum is insane, has a premise of whimsy. Almost not everyone, because there are some that see the situation for it as it is, but they're definitely not the therapists and the doctors and all these different roles. You realize there's something else. They're like a different kind of fish. You know, it's, you can tell that they're coming from a very different place. So by and large, we live and dwell all our days in a mental institution, severely insane, based on the premise of whimsy. So that is the trouble. I mean, that makes it very difficult to get the perspective on the situation, which means you really have to work at it. All the great realizers have said, look, if you want to get free of this lunacy, you really have to work at it every day. You really have to. You have to make that your goal in life. Because the answer is quite different than what you think. See, the people, we're trying to gain some feeling of competency, really. But the way we're trying to do it is impossible. We'll never get it. Because we're trying to feel competent in changing ourselves, which we cannot change ourselves. So there's no way to get that feeling of competency. And then we end up going deeper and deeper into just triviality. You know, like, you know, the capital of Idaho is what? I know. Actually, I don't know. I just assume it's Boise's, probably not. But anyway, you know, we end up, and people are screaming and cheering, and, you know, just like, wow, you know, you got it right, you're so wonderful. All these, like, television, like, you see all these people giving pep rallies for the most trivial stuff that people do. You know, it's like, you did this, and everyone says, you're so wonderful, I love you so much, you're so beautiful, you're so beautiful, you're so competent, you know. They're just desperately trying to build self-esteem. Lunatics, lunacy, absolute lunacy. I just shake my head and just, God, that's sad. Very sad. You have to have some sense of humor, but it's still very sad to see that just this whole culture of you're my friend, I'm your friend, I have so many friends, you know, we're all friends, we're all trying to build this, say, look, you must be a good person because you have so many friends on Facebook. And it's like, what are you talking about? They're trying to build what, quote-unquote, self-esteem. This whole self-esteem thing is nuts. Absolute nuts. We're trying to build our own self-esteem of it. Why? Based on what? Our ability to change what we really are. Thinking that, you know, yay, we can, yes, we can do it. Yes, we can. If we just have enough friends cheering us on, we'll be able to do it. So we got some hope. We got some hope. You know, just wandering through this mental institution, you just, you really... It's a real bummer, you know, just like, wow. You see classroom after classroom after classroom, and what's going on in those classrooms, you just, God, yeah, absolute lunacy. And just, you just don't want to deal with it anymore. No, come on, can't take it anymore. I've got to get out of this syndrome, you know. So up in the corner of this institution, on this ground, it's all fenced and everything. There's an area that's not fenced, it's wide open, actually. You can just walk right in and right out of the grounds. So what there are, there's teachers, there's some people that hang out there in that area. And people can kind of be attracted to them and say, who are they up there? What are they up there? And of course, the doctors of the institution say, well, those are the ones that are really, 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 really in bad shape. And we sort of have to isolate them up there. You know, for their own good and for your good too. We don't want them mixing with you because they might, you know, their insanity could rub off on you and you might have a setback. You might have a setback, so gotta keep them up there. And like that. Oh, okay. Poor people. Pity them. Pity. Really pitiful. So, yeah. But actually, this area is no fencing, no defense, wide open. You can go in, you can go out, just like that, just like that. And they just can't admit it. They don't want to admit it at all. It says, no, it's not possible. Those must be the real severe hopeless cases up there. The hopeless cases. That's where the hopeless cases are. You don't want to be a hopeless case, do you? Yeah, so you got to stay in the classroom. And cheer, somebody, you just had a makeover. He says, now I feel so beautiful. And everyone goes, ah, you go, girl. You feel so beautiful. Yes, I have such, you know, my self-esteem. I think I'm a wonderful person. I'm, you know, blah, blah, blah. Oh, you're so great. You know, that's the whole world is caught up in this frenzy of trying to boost self-esteem, which is not the right way. It's complete nuts, totally nuts. Real self-esteem comes from listening to the Holy Spirit and being advised of the situation that we cannot change what we are. So it's impossible to develop self-esteem based on that. And yet it's okay because the Holy Spirit can deal with whimsy for us. and deal with the whimsy for us. And indeed, that's what its purpose is. You know, we can't change our functionality. We can't change the Holy Spirit's functionality. So, but the two together, it's all perfect because the Holy Spirit deals with our, you know, continuity issue, deals with whimsy for us and shows us here's how. So we're okay. We can get free of this insane asylum. And we pray that we do as soon as possible. And I hope that I do as soon as possible. I understand there's this, you know, this drag on it. But I have to feel that it's going to happen. In the meantime, we keep up these pep talks. These are the real pep talks. These are the kind of pep talks that you should be in every classroom. These are the type of pep talks. I mean, people can use these videos in their classroom if they're teachers, because I put them in Creative Commons. Anybody can use these videos to instruct people. You know, that's what I would expect, that people have classrooms or meetings or whatever and say, okay, we're going to spend some time now. Let's have a real pep rally about our true self-esteem. And you can show these videos and people start saying, hey, you know, maybe I've been trying to do it the wrong way. Maybe I've been basing my self-esteem on the impossible. That's why I feel so incompetent. Oh, yeah, huh. So I don't really need to keep trying to do the impossible. Maybe that's why I felt so terrible. And all these therapists are telling me I need to feel better about myself. They're nuts, too, because that's also, they're still based on accomplishing the impossible. So I need to de-link myself from this whole scenario of therapy and get into this new type of therapy, which is really actually what actually works. People can catch that drift. They can catch that drift if they're not lazy. Laziness is the only thing that gets in the way. That's what the Holy Spirit told me. When I started out, the Holy Spirit said, I said, no, I can't. I'm not interested. And the Holy Spirit said, why? Is it too tough for you? And I said, no. Then the Holy Spirit said, then you're lazy. You're lazy. And I said, you're right. It's just, and then I said, okay, I'm not going to be lazy. So laziness is really the only issue that gets in the way, the only one. And that's, you know, that's something that's motivated from within. We don't like to think of ourselves as actually being lazy. So if you're not lazy, then you can definitely catch the drift of this, no question about it. Now, I may not stick with you, but you can catch the drift, because it's very simple, very basic. I said, ha, trying to repair my self-esteem, trying to build my self-esteem based on the belief I can change my functionality and how well I can, how confident I am in thinking that I can do that is nuts. That is insanity. Okay, so the institutions that tell me this is the way to go, those institutions themselves are insane. Insane asylum is insane, actually. and we can see that and say, oh, instead, I can base my self-esteem on not trying to change what I am, my functionality, not trying to change it, accepting that I can't change it. That brings the return of real self-esteem. That's what brings the returns it. And the Holy Spirit will show us a picture of our self-esteem, really. That's really what it is. Hey, whimsy has been nullified. And then that will really get a sense of self-esteem, like, wow, because the Holy Spirit is really part of reality. And so we'll feel great about reality, say, wow, reality, you really were able to nullify whimsicality. That's fabulous. Thank you, God. That's absolutely fabulous. And we'll feel great about ourselves. We'll feel really, really great about ourselves. That's the way. So if you want to use these videos again, you can have meetings in your house, meetings place, put it up on a screen, a monitor, show the videos, and people can listen and consider it and say, huh, it's something worth considering, you know. Sort of pointing out that there's a big dichotomy here. Like they say, well, I wonder, I've been brutalized, my whole life I've been brutalized. And now I'm like saying, hey, I wonder if this is really, that there's some freedom from this actually. It seems like there could be actual freedom from this and not in the way that I was thinking. And it starts to seep in. It starts to seep in. So hopefully at some point people will show the videos to a person, to a group, themselves, friends, whatever, you know, put it up and why not? Why not? That's why I make all the videos. Creative Commons belong to spirit. They belong to spirit, which is all of us. All of us. Meaning anyone can use these videos to at least get the flow going. You know, catch the drift, catch the drift, catch the drift. Just a little catch of the breeze. Just a little breeze in the sail. The sailboat starts moving and people say, hey, my sailboat can move. You know, most of us have been stuck in the doldrums. No wind in our sails at all. And here we are, you know, fussing about the rudder, you know, and thinking that there's something wrong with my boat. My boat is, I got a bad boat. Yeah. Now, there's just no wind. There's just no wind. And so when the wind of truth and facts come, then they fill your sails and the boat starts to move. And you say, hey, wait a minute, my boat seems to be okay. Wow, maybe I am okay. And, you know, it's just to catch the drift. It's an inner thing. It's not to be smart or not to be loquacious and not to be able to da 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 everybody. It's just to get this sense of, hey, an inner sense like, whoa, I think I've been tricked. I think I've been tricked here, and I think I see how I've been tricked, and I think I'm hearing the remedy, and it sounds to me like that is the remedy. Okay. And then, you know, people will work at it their own speed, in their own way. Everyone has a way to disengage from this insane asylum. But they do need to get this sense they're not alone. You know, the others have also caught this drift. And it's not too difficult to explain or understand. And it can help. And that's the education. As far as I'm concerned, there is no education on this planet. So we need to start an education. At some point, we have to start being educated. And there are some out there that are starting. I can tell they've been working on their education. It's obvious. If I listen to them or whatever, I can tell like that. You know, it's obvious. It's obvious that they have actually, you know, are engaged in the educational effort. Because they're able to consider these things, turn around this way and that way, and let them, you know, just an overall evaluation and allow themselves to be moved maybe this way or that way. Or they have better perspective, and they say, they allow the wow moment and the ah, and they're not, you know, they're not interested in all the trivia stuff. It's like, no, this interests them. This is vitally important. So it's obvious that there are some who are actually getting an education to some extent, but we need a much, much better education. It needs to be much more streamlined, more high-powered, more intense, more urgent, and people really have to get the momentum. The spiritual path has to be taken with a lot of momentum. Otherwise, the old habits will creep up and pull you back down. That is very true, isn't it? I mean, we can make breakthroughs. This morning I made so many breakthroughs, and then suddenly, gone, just an instant. I can't even remember what they were, and I said, wow, doggone, that's terrible. So I had to fight to get them back, and got them back, and then they lost them again. Just one little train of thought, poof. I can't even remember what the insight was. Bad habits. So, momentum is important. Pushing it through, keeping it going, is very important. And there are even some elder people who are still pushing it through. I've noticed that there are some who have been doing it. You can tell that their life has been engaged with this struggle, for sure. And that's a great thing. And there's some young people who are already engaging in the struggle. And there's some middle-aged people, etc. So there are people from all demographics and walks of life who are actually taking up this effort, this struggle to actually be educated. But they need to use any and all expediencies to keep the momentum going. So I hope I can make even better videos at some point. Maybe the videos will be worth people. Say, hey, you know what, I'd like to show that to, you know, some other people, and let's get to catch the drift. Start catching this drift. When you see it, you know you've seen it. There's something inside you. You know, your heart might skip a beat. You might say, "Oh, wow! I just saw it. I just realized this is all bogus. This whole institution. I'm not insane. I'm not insane at all. I've been trying to follow an impossible quest, which is whimsical. And this whimsicality, I can't deal with it. I can't deal with it, but the Holy Spirit can. You know, that registers. The Holy Spirit can deal with it. I can't." And that totally changes your outlook. Totally, right? You stop hating yourself. You stop berating yourself. You know, the whole dynamic changes just from that little recognition. You say, "Wow, I can't do the impossible. I wasn't created to do this, but the Holy Spirit was. The Holy Spirit was created for this. Ah, I'm going to be rescued. I'm going to be rescued from this." And then to work expectations align in that direction. Keep aligning it that way. So don't waste any day in your efforts. Don't waste any day in your efforts. All right. Very great. We will continue on. And I expect the videos to get you better and better and better and better and better. And soon. Absolutely very soon. All right. That's it.